Should we now start to think about living in the inwards, as well as talking about the hows of the things that you said are actually important?
Looking inwards, by the way, I think this crisis that we are going through as a country, which we have gone through in the past and we didn't quite take advantage of, I think it's good that we are going through it now with the kind of leadership we have at the national level. Because everybody's talking about looking in your world. Everybody's talking about local substitutes and so on and so forth. So it's not just in raw materials that you will have local substitutes. Even in the HR space, talking about training, talent development to ensure that people are capable of doing their jobs is not a new phenomenon. Even though HR and various practices are relatively new in Nigeria, not only in Nigeria, in most parts of the world, you know, HR in the form that we know it today. But when it's about developing talents to do what will transform your business performance, it's not a new phenomenon. It's been existing for as long as the military have been existing anywhere in the world. And what do I mean by that? If you look at the Nigerian military, for instance, they don't invite FITC or all the other service providers to come and train their men. In fact, they have a system that runs like the university system. Before the NDA was renamed, you know, a university, or even the status of a university, Nigerian Military School, Nigerian Military Development platforms have been existing. And what you have in the university system is an undergraduate comes in, he learns from the postgraduate students, he learns from the lecturers who are doctorate degree holders, he learns from the professors. The postgraduate students learn from the professors. The professors develop, they supervise the doctorate projects. They are almost self-sufficient within the university system. Of course, they get input from outside, but if you look at the percentage, it's not much. It's like the military as well, the same thing. In the industry, we can't be like them, but we can be better than we are today. I believe there is a baseline that should not be outsourced. I believe there is a baseline that industries should ensure their managers and their leaders provide, you know, the resource for. Just like in the university system, the professors train others. Senior executives should train those at the middle level. Those at the middle level should train those that are new to supervisory roles. Those that are in supervisory roles should train operatives. Now, that does not mean they will have everything. Just like even for the military, they don't have everything. They still go out there. They visit industry. They go to Kuru in Jos. You know, Kuru near Jos. They won't have everything. The industry cannot have everything. But look, this is a model that works in several organizations. I'm fortunate I started my career with Procter & Gamble. That's where I spent the first 14 years of my career. And from the day I left the university with my degree in engineering till I became head of HR for West Africa, I did not take any training outside of Procter & Gamble except industrial and labor related trainings from NECA, because that the company did not have. That is local. That is purely related to our laws in Nigeria. So what I'm saying in essence is there should be a base. I'm not saying everybody should be like Procter & Gamble where they do everything within. And by the way, they don't recruit from outside. All the CEOs that they have in history started their career with the company as
graduate trainees. They are trying to change that a little bit now, but not by much, okay? I'm not advocating that every organization should have all their trainees resourced from within. But I'm saying there should be a baseline. I know it varies for different organizations, but at times like this, the period we are going through is a period that calls for looking for substitute from first within your organization. Now, who is the best to train milling technician on how to mill high quality flour for making bread? It's not somebody from outside. It's not somebody from the university who will come and teach the theory. It's the guy that has been doing it for 20 years and he knows what good bread flour looks like. However, when it comes to advances in management practices and so on and so forth, I will need input from outside. That input will not be taking hook, line, and sinker theoretically. I will adapt it to what works for me based on the kind of business I run. So what I'm saying in essence is, take a look at those training interventions you've been investing money on. Look at those that you source from outside of your organization. If they are from within Nigeria, can they be from within your company? Do you have subject matter experts within that hitherto had been behaving like, I'm just here to produce, it's none of my business to train. HR should find ways to train my people. Can you open the eyes of your organization to see that huge opportunity and what it means, not only in terms of the money you will save, but also in terms of how related the experience will be for your people? Unlike somebody that is good at training maintenance technicians for Nestle, for different kinds of organizations. But this one knows the organization that you're talking about, and will be able to give his own personal experiences and insider's knowledge, apart from training the basic skills. Think about it. Challenge your organization about it. Somebody has spoken about all these overseas trainings. Believe me, the way I look at overseas training that some of us do is just like reward for our loyal friends. If you use it as a reward for top performers, it's good. And sometimes I tell them, look, this is not just for you to go and attend this positive power and influence program. It's also for you to go and see some other parts of the world and have your horizon broadened. But it's also a recognition of the contributions you've been making to the business. So go and relax. It's not just about training, training, training. If our employees are properly engaged, it's a good time to call them and let them know we can't afford that luxury this year. The essential component in it is the skill that they need to learn. And you can access that with a local substitute. Or you bring the experts in to come and give it to a larger group of people. You can't cut training, but you can cut training costs. In fact, you need to train more in a challenging period like this.
When we are thinking of cost saving, if we have a dispassionate view and look at the entire value chain of the organization, you'll be surprised to see some places which I call the iceberg effect. They're not very obvious, but they are money guzzlers. So I know many of our clients, when we ask them to do that, they have this frozen look on their face. But when we finish and they see the analysis, they sit forward on their table. Many organizations spend so much on stationery. It doesn't make sense. Many organizations spend so much on postages, telephone. And if we can, as HR people, throw this back at the admin function, to look at something even as easy as closing time and price of diesel that we spend, and power, air conditioning, something as easy as our windows double glazed, the effect they have on cooling and heating and conserving energy. So when we look at those real areas of cost blowing, we can really see that sometimes the capacity to know where we should invest and where we should cut costs has a lot of impact on the sustainability of our entire organization. And going green is good for business. That's one thing I wanted to just flag there so that the HR people can actually throw the thing back. That, okay, I'm going to think about where to cut costs, but can we please look at our admin costs? Motor vehicle running expenses. We have old cars that are now costing so much for us to maintain. In terms of what we do and not cutting the benefits of welfare, if we used to have retainership with clinics, what is wrong with getting a holistic, very high premium, good quality health insurance? The premium is flat. You can determine your expenditure there because it's fixed for a period. You pay it and you know. And the insurer takes the risk of any unseen eventuality. Some organizations are still maintaining clinics and paying doctors as they are cost out. So looking at your value chain and saying, what am I in business for? And what do I need to run the business? Sometimes it might not be that effective to have a clinic, because I've spoken to some large major organizations in this country, and you'll be amazed how much they spend on running the clinic, how much they spend on medical care, and some people even go check their blood pressure abroad. That was a joke. Now the other side on training, which we do, my brother Wale had hinted some of it. And you know, people, when we say, when he was having that conversation with me, I said, exactly, that's what we actually advocate at FIT. He was shocked that our view could have been just send your people to us. But I told him that our approach has been, we have a lot of, we enjoy, because we are member-based and we're not profit-oriented, we can really value a relationship for the long haul. And when you do that, money ultimately comes in, but it is not your main driver. So for that reason, some of our clients who have actually advocated for them in a consulting assignment that they should set up an academy type journey. And we actually help them to create a base structure, like a journey, 2 years, 3 years, this is how the academy will look like. And we also help them as a consulting intervention to develop curriculum, have a structure, define the roles, and even help them to pick people whom we would offer training of trainers sessions for in terms of developing curriculum. And then we'll now give them, we'll do learning needs as analysis for their organization and come up with programs that they could actually develop a core faculty within. That core faculty that Wale spoke about has many benefits. One, it builds your culture. Two, it puts some of your leaders forward as role models. They become ambassadors of the brand. And they actually help your retention, because they are now interested in the people, not just in the output, but in the capacity development. And they also make awesome supervisors. Now, the other side again is that when you have a class that is internal like that, every class can actually walk away with a project that they can implement after that session. Then the training cost per person, if you look at it, is actually a fraction of when you send people outside. And you could also do that even for the foreign program. I can tell you, we have a program we send our people to, and one particular program would be like $5,000, $6,000 for tuition. But even next year, we would have foreign program in FIT. This year, we'll have foreign program in FITC, but how we'll do it is that we will have a class that is all FITC people, and the foreign resource will come in, and we'll pay the flight ticket and everything of that person. At the end of the day, you have not incurred ESTA code, you have not bought ticket for these your people to go, and then you can actually sit inside as a group. We have about two clients, especially one that we love very much. We actually, they have an academy that's about 3 years old now. We help them to set up the academy. And my stakeholders will be hearing me now. I'm supposed to have 21 stakeholders, and I'm saying I love one.
I was going to pick you up on that.
So. No, I'm not going to disclose, no disclosures. That one, we helped them to set up the academy, and we helped them with the money. And at the end of the day, we went back after 2 years to assess how effective the academy has been. And then we recommended things they should be considering, which they have incorporated into this year's budget. Then there's another one that is a major bank in this country, that had their academy, which is doing very well, we helped them even to select the service providers to that academy. The selection process happened in FITC with the head of the academy and some of the staff of the academy and some of my colleagues. We sat down and every provider came and made presentation, and we helped them to choose their providers. At the end of the day, you ask, what's the benefit in it for FITC? We are able to have an input on the quality of what our stakeholder is doing. And if they have that quality, they appreciate capacity building. They will come back to us. We have some programs we run for them, but we're not interested in monopolizing all their programs. We know they can afford to do some by themselves. And then some of the programs also that are especially hygiene issues, like standards that you operate by. This is as awesome as e-learning. I used to be with a firm, which I shall not name, is one of the global four, and we had annual online trainings. That's because the franchise, the global franchise, has ways of doing things that is brand aligned. Various standards that we have signed up for, processes. So now, to make sure that everybody is on the same page, such trainings are online. They are downloaded from the global database. You have a time check, and at the end of the day, you get a percentage pass. If you don't pass, you keep doing that test until you have passed. And when you pass, your certificate is already uploaded into your database. Those things can only be done cost effectively by virtual learning. But some trainings that are demonstrative, that are character forming, you can't do them online. You need that human interface. So the right mix of what to do. I have seen organizations that say we have virtual learning, and all they have is group email and PowerPoint attachment. Mm. They call it e-learning. You know, group email, a certain group, they say, okay, you guys, that's your e-learning model. You look at it, and it's nothing than PowerPoint presentation sent to a group of people. That is not what we're talking about. We're talking about a learning management system, a platform that people can log in, somehow interactive. You can download things and you can do things. And we've also extended that to provide it to our stakeholders. For instance, we have two models on our, as one of our relationships with the digital world. We have two models that we have, which is credit administration, which is generic to bankers. And anybody working in the bank, whatever function you're doing, at least you have an appreciation of credit, because banks collect money from somebody.
Somebody gives to somebody and making money. The other one is internal control. There are processes and procedures which, if you don't comply with, you lose your license, your people go to jail. So these two courses are generic to everybody. And we have them as virtual learning, but the advanced portion become the class. And for people who are like in diaspora, they want to work in Nigeria, they don't understand some basic things, those are very good things for them to have before they come for their interview. And they're very low cost. So on that note, so I don't keep talking. Have I covered it?